What's up everyone, welcome to episode 14 of Only for the Strong. Today's guest is an IFBB Classic Physique competitor, as well as the owner of the fitness portal gym in Wellington, Tim Fox. How are you, brother?
Yeah, good man, thank you. How are you?
Good, I'm great. So the first thing I wanted to just crack into with you is just tell me a little bit about how you got into training and competing and how that led to you opening the fitness portal gym.
Yeah, so I didn't have a traditional intro into bodybuilding. I actually am at, I got brought up racing cars and go-karts before that. And this is what originally got me into training in the gym. Once I got to my early 20s and I'd been racing for about 10 years by that point, I started just developing a love of training itself and enjoying going into the gym, doing more of, you know, like the bodybuilding style of training at that point. And that's really where I started to, I suppose, not in a vain way, but get more into like my physique, my aesthetic, you know, seeing what my body was capable of in that sense. And it kind of went from there. So like my first comp was when I was 20, I believe, back in 2014. Just did board shorts back then, men's physique. And then it was 3 years after that that I did my second show in 2017. And then it was another 3 years before I competed again in 2020. And I've competed the last 3 years after that in Classic.
And then how did that kind of lead you into the fitness portal?
So the fitness portal came about in 2019. As I said, I was always into training, and so I'm an electrician by trade. And so I'd finished my qual for that, you know, became a registered electrician, and who's now my business partner, Devin, was PTing me at that time, prior to when I trained with Philly, my coach at the moment. And I wasn't actually competing at that time, and he came to me. Like I said, he was PTing me, and then I'd always wanted to own a gym. I'd always wanted to be a PT. He was training out of City Fitness Lower Hutt at the time. He came to me and said, basically, look, like there's some openings for PTs. They want some more people. Are you interested? And basically, in the space of a few weeks, my whole life sort of changed, because obviously, being a Sparky, I was working, you know, 50, 60 hour weeks. I was running jobs, my own jobs at that time as well. So, you know, guys under me. So I was working 6 days a week, obviously. And so I had to leave all that behind, basically, to start my personal training journey. And when I started that, I started my own electrical company at the same time, simply because I knew that I wasn't going to be able to keep working for someone else and doing PT at the same time, which I obviously wanted to do. So Black Fox Electrical was born, and I started my PTing journey. And it was about 6 months into my PTing journey in 2018 when my dad, who owns the building that Petone Fitness Portal was located in, said that his tenant at the time was going to move out. And he knew that I'd wanted to open a gym. But he also knew that it was probably a bit too soon. So he came to me, said that. Then I was like, well, you know, I'll see what I can do. And then basically had a chat to Devin. And I was like, hey, like this opportunity's come up. What do you say? Like, should we give it a crack? And that's kind of what led to the start of the fitness portal.
So I think opening a gym is something a lot of people want to do, but few follow through with. What does that process actually look like of opening a gym? Because I think it's something that's super glorified, but I'm sure it's been frickin' testing at times. And how's it going now? Because you've got two locations, so you're obviously expanding fast, but obviously I'm sure with that comes growing pains.
Yes, absolutely. It wasn't easy. I mean, Petone is quite small. It's relatively small. It's about 300 square meters, give or take. And because we didn't, our vision was always to have, like, I suppose you'd call it more of a mainstream facility. So something where everybody is welcome, obviously. We're 24/7. Everyone can go to it all the time. And with that, it's not quite like a, you know, like a functional gym, like a CrossFit gym or something like that, where you need almost the bare minimum. Obviously, because of what we wanted, we needed things like group fitness. We needed things like, obviously, top of the range equipment. We needed to have a big range of everything. And so I suppose that the hardest bit was obviously capital, right? Like with any new business, especially one with instant overheads such as rent and staff, that kind of thing. Capital was our biggest and always has been sort of our biggest holdback. We're not someone like, can't remember the owners of City Fit's name, but he came to New Zealand with $10 million and injected that into City Fitness, and that's what created City Fitness. We don't have $10 million, so we literally just worked with our network of friends and family and originally raised that money off of that. Raised the money that we needed, which for the first one was about $150,000 to $200,000. Raised that over a number of months and basically just grinded our way through that first year. And then, of course, COVID hit. And then that threw a whole new curveball, as it did for a lot of people. And we were quite lucky to survive that and come out the other side in a position strong enough to open Tower, our second location.
Before jumping on today, I had seen your gym and on socials, and I know of a few like friends that train there. And I think for me, I've spent a lot of time in gyms around the country. And I honestly think the biggest, I guess, struggle point for a lot of gyms is the environment and the culture they create, because with a lot of gyms nowadays, especially the likes of like City Fitness and Les Mills, it is just about getting members signed up and getting them in the gym. But for anyone who's actually into their training, the environment and the culture is quite a big thing. Looking from the outside, it looks like your gym has quite a good culture, has quite a good vibe. Is that something you actually have tried to cultivate, or that's just something that's happened organically?
That was always our goal. That was something that we always wanted to cultivate, something that we strived ourselves to really achieve. And to be honest, if we hadn't had that Petone, especially during COVID, we wouldn't have survived. That's just the you know, to be blunt about it. And so that's always been our vision, and that's always going to be our vision. We're never going to open a facility, and we're not going to expand too fast where we can't achieve that. We're always going to maintain that community spirit, and also at the same time have a home, I suppose, for athletes. And I mean, I'm not sure if you've seen, but we actually have an athlete program now where we've got currently 5 athletes on that in a range of different sports, not just bodybuilding. A couple are starting their IFBB journey this year. And, you know, that just sort of, that speaks volumes, right? Like, that's exactly what we're about. That's what we're trying to promote. And that's where we want to go.
What's the long-term goal with the gym? Like, more locations or just take over Wellington, or?
Start with New Zealand. So the next stage is Auckland. So I just moved up here at the end of January, about 3 or 4 weeks ago now. Both to expand Black Fox Electrical, so the electrical side is already up here and running, but also we're opening a gym up here this year, hopefully around July. It should be good to go. We're just finalising a few details at the moment. And then we're due to have one in Kapiti, hopefully next year, and then there should be another one in Auckland in 2025, we think. And then, yeah, we'll see who's interested in opening. Potentially down in Christchurch around that time as well. And then past that, obviously we want to have around 8 to 10 gyms in New Zealand, and then ideally look overseas, look into Australia would be the next natural step.
Is it getting less daunting and easier, like, as you open another location, or is it just worse because it's just more locations?
This one for Auckland is probably the most daunting so far, just because it's the biggest one so far. It's also obviously the biggest, how should I put this? It's the most commitment financially that I've put into any of them so far. Obviously, just with being in Auckland, you know, we're going pretty center, pretty central in Auckland. So with that comes a fair bit of commitment, a fair bit of responsibility. But, you know, we have a good team behind us now, and we've got, you know, we've created the backbone for this. Like, we're not going too far out of our depth in that sense. It's just more or less trying to raise the capital and to keep that, like you say, that community spirit in between each gym and keep the facilities the same style, more or less. Like, we don't want to, like I said, we don't want to expand so fast that we lose track of what is us.
Yeah, I feel like gyms are something similar to, like, personal training, for example, where everyone always says, oh, there's so many of them already, why would you do that? But I feel like, especially in New Zealand, we're actually not, that quality of gyms and facilities is actually quite poor, especially now for how many people are into training and into the gym. Would you say that, like, the reason you've been able to grow and expand, because a lot of gyms aren't, like, there's a lot of older chains who have heaps of locations that haven't opened up locations in the last 5 years, you know? Do you think that your ability to grow as you have is just down to the culture? Or is there anything else in particular that you think you'd put that down to?
Oh, I think there's quite a few things that lead to that. I think, obviously, like we say, culture is a big part of it. But I also think offering, you know, that high level of equipment and staff and that kind of thing obviously backs us as well. And that's obviously why we want to still be able to maintain that and control that going forward, so that we don't slip. You know, like, we don't want to open three gyms at once, so, because we'll just be spread too thin at this point. We want to be able to stage it in a way where we can maintain that, keep growing that. You know, like, we've got things like in-house functional training, you know, very similar to CrossFit, obviously. But we have the trainers capable, you know, of doing that, of training that. We're not just throwing people in the deep end and expecting them to know what they're doing, because not everybody knows that, just like not everyone knows bodybuilding. You know, every little niche needs its trainers, needs its expertise there in-house to be able to grow that. And I think that's potentially what makes us quite different.
Yeah, because even I've noticed that, like, just moving recently and gyms that I've been in over the years, a massive, again, I guess, barrier that I think happens is a lot of people buy gyms, they're not really actually that keen on the training. It is just a business, which that's fair enough, but you head into these gyms that are like new gyms and also gyms that have been revamped, and they'll stock it out with this line of equipment, like, not to like bash anyone in particular, but there's this line of equipment called Techno Gym. I'm not sure if you've got any of that stuff in your gym. But, like, for the most part, a lot of their machines aren't great. And anyone, you wouldn't even have to be experienced to jump in them and know that, like, okay, this is not a great machine, even though it looks kind of cool. But regardless, people will still go and stack the whole gym out with it. And I just think it's such a waste, because the argument is, oh, only experienced people will care about the brand of equipment. And I just think that's complete rubbish, because if someone is new coming into the gym and they want to progress and they want to get the best results and, I guess, feel the best in their movements, a better quality machine is only going to help that. And I think, have you put a little bit of effort into the equipment you selected, and how did you go about that?
Absolutely. Like, we hunted around a bit. We also talked to, for instance, like, my coach, Philly, who's also, who is it currently, our head trainer, Taylor, who's also, he's coming up to Auckland to start the Auckland gym with me. His coach as well, like, he obviously has been around for a long, long time, especially in bodybuilding circles. And so we actually talked to him before opening Tawa, and we're just basically like, you know, who do you recommend that we go to? Because we've gone with, it's a brand called Matrix for Petone, which is, it's good. It is good, but we wanted one that's a bit more brand aware to us. So, like, what you'll notice, particularly on Instagram, I suppose, is all of our equipment, all of our machines, they're all painted in our colours, like the black and the blue. And so it all looks the part. And that's also something that we want to be able to maintain and keep gym to gym, so that when you step into a fitness portal facility, it doesn't feel like an unknown territory, even if you're, you know, down in Wellington or up in Auckland or wherever you are, it feels kind of familiar. But along with that, we wanted machines and equipment that feels right. You know, like, it's got the right range of movement that you need to grow those muscles, or whatever you're doing. Because, like you say, there is heaps of equipment out there. I mean, personally, I think the worst ones that I've noticed is Star Trek, what City has. There's just, I don't know, you jump on like one of their chest presses, you just can't feel the chest activation. Whereas you jump on something, you know, like Hammer Strength or your traditional stuff, and it's just like, you don't even really need to try and you can really notice it activating in the right areas. And that's exactly what we wanted to go for, is equipment that can achieve that, because that, along with the right people, the right PTs, the right staff, that's what makes that difference, right? That's what makes things interesting. And then having that variety, because I think, especially we've got some more, another shipment coming in shortly for Tala, but we've got a big range of equipment that neither gym, especially Wellington, has. You know, little things like a plate-loaded chest fly. You know, you just don't see them in New Zealand. You see them all over Instagram, like in the States, you know, overseas, but you never see them in New Zealand. So it's trying to bring all that to New Zealand and giving everyone the opportunity to use all that kind of stuff.
And then the other thing you touched on there is also trainers. And I think trainers can really make or break a gym. And I think you being a trainer has probably helped you just, I guess, set up a good structure for PTs to thrive. Is getting trainers in been something that's proved difficult, or you found it quite easy because you have a good network? And just how have you found that in terms of building your gym? Because I feel like just one thing to add to that is you go in some gyms and like you're in there 1 week and there's three trainers, and then you go back the next week and two of them are gone and there's two new ones. And for someone who's
high rate of turnover.
Yeah, someone who's quite into their training, you're probably not using a trainer anyway. But to me, if I'm a new person coming into the gym and I'm seeing the trainers switch over weekly, because that's honestly what it can be, it's just a bit strange. It's definitely not alluring to getting a trainer, you know?
Yeah, absolutely. I think I completely agree with you. I think trainers can make or break the space. It's something that, to be honest, it hasn't come too easily to us. But that's something that we're growing at the moment, and we've got obviously the right staff in place to grow that, like in terms of my business partner Devin, and then also my business partner Taylor. That's kind of their area, like they go in and they search for the right trainers to bring in. You know, Dev was head coach back at City Fit, so he's got some experience there, and Taylor's been a PT for a number of years, you know, at the likes of Les Mills as well. So between all of us, yeah, we know sort of what we're looking for, I suppose, is the easiest way to put it. We also now offer apprenticeships in-house. So Devin is qualified in offering, I think it's the level 4 quals to get people qualified as a personal trainer, which gives us that opportunity to really like mold trainers into how we believe that they should be training at quite a high level, as opposed to just, you know, pumping through as many people as we can to increase our profits. We're not really about that. More about trying to create an experience for the people so that they actually learn and you know, don't just learn the basics, they learn the stuff that we believe people should know, but that often doesn't get taught.
So now getting more into the bodybuilding side of things, what is your relationship like with competing? Is the goal to compete at a high level, or is it simply you kind of are doing it for the love of it at this stage alongside the business?
Yeah, so I mean, my goal has always been to get to quite a high level of it. I don't know, like coming from a background of motorsport as well and individual sports, like I'm quite a competitive person. Like when I do something, I like to try and do it well and to the best of my abilities. So my goal has always been to turn pro, and that I'm still striving for. I don't think I'm going to compete this year, but I have competed the last 3 years in a row. So I believe that I just need a little bit more time to put on some more size. Over the last 3 years, I think I've put on roughly sort of 7 or 8 kilos of stage weight, which is quite a bit, especially in classic physique where we have that weight cap involved. But I still have a few more kilos to put on in the right areas to really make my physique pop and get to the point where I don't want to just get the pro card just to get it. Like when I win my pro card, that's the start of the next chapter, you know. Like I want to feel like I can go on the pro stage next to pros in other countries in the States and not be just left behind. Like I want to be able to stand up there and be proud of what I've achieved and be able to push them, you know, for those top placings. And obviously that just takes time.
Yeah, for sure. I had an interesting chat. I had a young female competitor, Georgia Patching. I don't know if you've heard of her. Yeah, I think she might have came and trained at your gym at one stage when she was in Wellington.
But yeah, she has.
Yeah, she made it because we were talking about pro cards. And I used to be, like, I used to compete at an amateur level and follow that scene quite hard out. Not as much anymore. But it seemed, from what I've noticed, is that pro cards are obviously just handed out a lot more nowadays. And that's to grow the sport, and that's great. But what I've seen is the guys who win their pro card a little easier then go over to an international scene and get absolutely mollywopped for the most part of it. And she made an interesting point. I think she wanted to... She said basically the same thing as you, that when she wins it, she wants to actually, like, win it and then be competitive as a pro. And I think she said she almost wanted to go over... I don't want to misquote it, but go overseas and try and get it. Compete overseas in the States, maybe, to try and get it that way, which I thought was quite interesting.
Yeah, and to be honest, that's probably something that I'm also looking at doing. Mm. The past couple of years, obviously, they had a number of pro cards, and it was, you know, every regional show would be a pro card for either, you know, classic physique and bikini, or men's physique and wellness, or whatever, which was traditionally quite different to the old way, which they've now brought back for this year, which is you go to, you know, you place at your regional show, that qualifies you for nationals, and then if you win your class and then win the overall division, you win your pro card, which I think for a country of our size is probably a little bit more relevant. Like we just don't have the population base where we can keep handing out 3, 4, 5 pro cards in every division every year. Like we just don't have the number of athletes needed to keep up what I would consider a pro class of competitor. Like there's just, like, if we keep doing that, we're just going to run out of amateurs because everyone's going to be pros, right? Like we just don't have enough new talent coming through each year to keep up with that. I mean, we're only what, like 5 million people in this country. It's not, you know, that's the same size as Melbourne.
Yeah.
To put it in perspective, you know, that's like Melbourne itself just holding all these comps and handing out all these pro cards.
Yeah, I think as well it's hard because when you, especially as a younger person, and you're competing, the standard is so low. And like, I think I did 3 shows, and I only, like, I did NABBA shows in the South Island, so probably less competitive than like the ones in out of the ones in New Zealand. But even so, in those 3 shows, the first one I was a teen, and I had no one to compete against, and they just shucked me in with the junior men and didn't score me. The second one, I competed against 2 guys in the junior men's. And then the third ones, there was no one else in the junior men's, so they just chucked me with the men and didn't score me. So that's like 3 shows I did, like, 3 years consecutively. Yeah. And I had only really been judged against 2 people that whole time. And obviously it's like, that's 3, 4 years ago now, but it's still like, it gets a little bit disheartening. And my standard is so sort of skewed. Because in my head, that's when I was like, okay, if I really want to have a stab at this, I need to go somewhere else and do a bigger show. But then I probably would have been a little bit out of my depth, you know? So the pathway isn't super clear, which can be quite challenging.
Yeah, I'd agree with that. I'd agree with that. I mean, from a IFBB point of view, they've made it a little bit more clear. Like the whole idea now with competing is, you know, you can jump in. You know, you still have to train your heart out and eat all the right foods and do everything correctly. But the idea is to start something like board shorts and men's physique, right? And then once you're more, like, get some stage presence, get the feel for being on stage. Because honestly, like, you can practice the shit out of all your posing and everything. And then you get to the day and the nerves kick in. Mm. And then it's like, oh, wow, okay. You know, everything just goes out the window. So getting that stage presence, getting familiar with being up in front of everyone in something like men's physique, and then being like, okay, cool, like, that was a good start. Now where do I want to go? Do I want to, you know, push a little bit more, go to classic, you know, so that I can show off my legs, but I've still got that weight cap? Or do I just want to go all in and push it to the extreme and try to go to bodybuilding? So I think they've tried to lay out more of a path as opposed to what, 20 years ago, where it was just bodybuilding, like nothing else but bodybuilding. And I think, you know, like it's been good in a way to get more people make the sport more accessible, I suppose, is what they're trying to do, right? Like get more people through the door. Like, it's same with the females, the likes of like bikini and wellness. Like, you don't have to get absolutely ridiculously massive to be able to step on stage, and you can, because everyone's physique is different and everybody's body is different and unique, right? So, you know, you can almost pick a class to a degree as to what suits you, suits your shape and where you want to go. Because not everybody wants to get, you know, as big as Big Ramy and be like 300 pounds plus in the off season, you know, walking around like that. I think, I mean, obviously I'm biased because I am a classic competitor, but I think the look of classic is more desirable, obviously, than bodybuilding. And I think that's what's drawn, obviously, a lot of interest there. And then you've got the likes of Chris Bumstead, obviously, and like guys like that, that just bring so much to the sport, and just inspire a whole range of new competitors into it, which is great. Like, because obviously, if you don't have people like that, the sport will fizzle out.
How do you find, obviously, it's great for the business side of things, but obviously, training and competing has gotten a lot more mainstream, a lot more popular. Do you like that? Even kind of what I was asking you initially is, do you compete because you love bodybuilding and you love competing and you love the training? And or do you love like the actual scene of competing, I guess, and it getting more popular and it getting more mainstream and the way things are run, if you know what I mean?
Yeah, absolutely. No, I do love the sport. Like, I wouldn't do it if I didn't. Obviously, it is tough trying to run like the businesses and then also compete, because to compete well into a high level, it does take all of your time, like so much of your time, so much of your commitment, put strains on everything, like your relationships, your business, whatever. Like, it's gonna test that. So, you know, that's a big part of the reason that I've decided this year to take a step back, focus on my business for this year, because I knew that if I tried to open the Auckland gym, expand my other businesses up to Auckland, and then also try and train, I was just going to be biting off way, way too much, especially to achieve what I would expect of myself. Like, I'm not one to, not now, maybe in my first show, but where I'm at now, I don't just want to cut for 8 weeks and jump on stage and try and do my best. Like, it's a year-round commitment. So by doing that, I'm hoping that in 2024, I can focus up a bit more, focus back onto my training, my eating, everything else, and possibly compete overseas, possibly compete here, but really push myself and go for that top spot. And I feel like I'll deserve it, because that was the other thing with having heaps of pro cards, is if I, for instance, did do that this year, like just jumped into a comp, you know, 10 weeks cutting. Obviously year round, I train pretty bloody hard now and I eat, you know, relatively well. But, you know, if I did that and didn't give my all and then happened to win a pro card, I wouldn't feel like I deserved it. I don't know, like, some people are more than happy to do that, but personally, I'm not. Like, if I win that pro card, I want to feel like I deserved it. And, like, there's no question about that. But that's also me. I'm just a bit crazy. that's come with, you know, like, years of motorsport background, and then also in business as well.
Do you think about the like health and longevity side of bodybuilding, and not even physically, but just mentally? And you were saying just before how it takes such a toll on your relationships, your business. I think the good thing with you though is you have established a business, and that's something to the side of bodybuilding. If it was taken away from you, or if you just decided not to do it anymore, do you think about those sort of things, or you're a little bit more short term in your thinking?
No, of course. Like, anyone that knows me well will know that I overthink the shit out of everything, and I always look to the future. Like, I'm a big believer in having those 1, 3, 5, 10 year plans to always aim towards. And absolutely, like, I've thought about the longevity of everything, and like how it can all coexist and relate to each other. Obviously, with my business being largely the gym and fitness, you know, gym and fitness centered, that obviously does tie in with bodybuilding a bit, which I'm quite lucky with. If it didn't, then it would be even that much harder to justify, I suppose, being able to spend that much time on my training and on my eating and that kind of thing. But yeah, like, I know that I can't compete forever. And so that's where the business side is coming. But I do believe that I should be able to compete more or less sort of up until my mid to late 30s. And so that's why I've, you know, I'm more than happy to take a year now to continue to do that. But obviously the other side to it is there have been all the open bodybuilders dying at very young ages over the last few years. And I think that's really, you know, brought things into perspective for people, because, you know, jumping onto the like PD side of things, like, I can guarantee you they had all their doctors telling them that they're fine. You know, everyone was saying that everything's okay, but yet it still wasn't, right? Like, so there's obviously something there that's getting missed. Now you're talking about people that push everything to the absolute extreme and probably have been since they're like 17, 18 most of the time. And then it's been going on for 20 years pretty much non-stop, right? So obviously that amount of abuse on your body is going to reduce your life dramatically, no matter what you're doing. But yeah, I mean, that's obviously in every competitor's mind, I think, to a degree. And if it's not, it should be, because why would you want to simply, especially if you're only at an amateur level, and not really, because I mean, we're talking about people that are, you know, top 10, 20 in the world at what they do. But if you're not anywhere near that, then why push something to the absolute extreme where it could be doing that to your, you know, cutting your life short, essentially. Yeah. And then you, what do you have to show for it at the end of the day? Yeah,
I think it's a really important to just be aware of it. And at the end of the day, in any sport at a high level, there's consequences and there's risks. I think in bodybuilding, it's a little bit more extreme. And you mentioned the PEDs, but to be honest, I reckon even like the food, like, it's because you're literally abusing food, you know, the training, like, that you are, especially at a high level. Even like me, like, I'm not genetically built for the sport, but I would pride myself in my ability to train to a high level. And I'm so young, but my hip from training and just genetically as well, it's so stuffed. I've basically got like a 65-year-old hip, and that's a consequence I have to accept. And it's just like, I think it's the redlining all the time, competing all the time. Like, is that something you've gotten better at? Because that's something I've struggled with. I struggled with massively when I was a bit more into bodybuilding, as I would just redline all the time. And actually, I would probably make, like, I made a lot more progress than if I was just focused on being a bit more productive and took breaks and maybe did a few more social things with my friends and family. You know, is that something you've gotten better at?
It is, yeah. Like, I mean, in a short answer, yes. In a long-term answer, like, that's something where my coach has been awesome, and he's helped me massively through that. He's a big believer in less is more, in relation to a lot of things. But yeah, like, you need to be able to let go, right? Like, you can't just redline it all of the time, because that is when you'll get burnt out. I mean, like, normally for me, I'll have typically like the summers to chill out, more or less do what I want, spend time with friends. I do love going out and like, hanging out with my friends and that kind of thing. So that's probably the bit that I struggle with the most when I'm in prep for those, you know, 16, 20 weeks where it's just like grind, and, you know, you get to the weekend and it's like, cool, now I can sleep, you know. Like, I'd like going out with my mates when I'm in the off season and being able to enjoy that. And eating out, like, I'm a foodie. I think most bodybuilders are foodies, just simply because it's better than chicken and rice. But yeah, like, it's a balance. Like, I do think you need to be able to, so that you don't go insane, like, I think you need to be able to balance everything to a degree. And sure, when you're in that prep for the show, and when, you know, when your eyes are set on that goal, you go 100%, you go as hard as you can, but you still always need rest days. But that's the goal at that time. But in and around that, I do believe that you need to be able to let go somewhat and be able to hit reset and, you know, and just get your base, like, I don't know, zen yourself, whatever that may be. And that looks different for everybody. Everybody has their own way of chilling out and doing what they enjoy around the sport. But you definitely cannot, like, imagine having your car and they're just redlining it everywhere. Obviously, it's not going to last very long, right?
Mm.
But it's the same analogy for a human.
Mm.
Like, you can't just redline all the time. You'll just burn out.
Yeah. So the last question I wanted to put to you is, what specific skills do you think you've learnt from bodybuilding and training that you've been able to apply in a business setting?
Discipline. It's probably the biggest one. Discipline and focus, like being able to, yeah, focus on those specific goals. Like I mentioned, I am a big believer in having goals set, because I don't think, personally, I think if you're not writing down your goals and checking up on your goals and critiquing yourself, which is actually harder to do than what a lot of people give it credit for, then how do you know if you've actually achieved them or if you're heading in the right direction, long-term overall vision? And I think that's actually something that bodybuilding has taught me, to be fair, because like I said as well, it's not an overnight sport. Like, generally, I mean, I'm aiming for the comps next year. I'm not even thinking about this year. You know, we're talking 18 months away, and it's already sort of in my mind around how I'm going to get there, what I'm going to do, you know, where I want to be at by the end of 2023, so that going into 2024, I'm where I want to be. And that's the same with business. Like, business doesn't happen overnight. Everything takes time. Like, when Devin and myself started the fitness portal, we knew that wasn't going to be the only one.
Mm.
We weren't too sure how exactly we were going to expand, because the first one was such a struggle. Your first one is always the hardest. It's always, yeah, the first of everything is always the hardest, right? Like, biting the bullet, going self-employed, and then having the balls to kind of actually go in the direction that you want to go in, and then trying to make that work. It does get a little bit easier in some ways. So being able to focus up and being like, okay, in 5 years, we want to have 3 gyms spread out around the country. Not too sure exactly how that's going to work, but that should enlighten itself in due course.
Mm.
But actually having that goal and then breaking that down, okay, in 6 months, we need this many members to get to that stage, so that, you know, if we keep progressing in that way, we will have the funding that we need to be able to open a second facility. Yeah, it's simple breakdowns like that, but it's all process and due process. And it's the same with training and bodybuilding or whatever sport you're into. Like, if you're training to a high level and you've got that, say, nationals for whatever it is, you need to be able to break that down into segments and be like, okay, sweet, this is where I need to be in 3 months, this is where I need to be in 6, a year, whatever. Like, in 3 years, I want to be international. So that means next year, I need to be at the top in this country.
Mm. Do you feel like you'd be a bit lost if you didn't have like a few set goals?
Yeah, I would.
Mm.
I know it's not everyone's cup of tea, and I know everyone does operate differently. This is just what works for me.
Mm.
But yeah, I absolutely would. I can't operate without having goals in mind.
Yeah. Can you remember back to your first show, and at the end of it, do you remember what the feeling after that was? It like quite anticlimactic?
Relief.
Mm.
that was nerve wracking. Like, mm. I don't know. I didn't have a coach as such for that. I actually never even watched a bodybuilding show.
Really?
I stepped on the stage for the first time. And so I got out there and I was way, way out of my depth.
Mm.
And back then, the way that IFBB did it, I'm not too sure how NABBA did it. Did they have a morning show and a night show?
Yeah.
When you did it?
Yeah.
Yeah, so it was the same for us. So I think I stepped on stage at like 10 a.m. in the morning for pre-judging. Like I said, it's in board shorts, so it was pretty simple. Like, you know, you don't have to do a routine as such. You just go up and show off what you've worked on, I suppose. Did that, you know, that finished at like 2 o'clock. Went and grabbed some more food, obviously, kept carving up. I mean, I don't think I stepped off stage that night until like 9:30, 10 o'clock.
Mm.
So it was just... Oh, it was such a long day.
Yeah.
Such a long day. There was about 115 competitors or something like that. It was too much.
Yeah, you know, mine was sort of the same. I remember, like, nothing was even open to get food after. And so I literally just went to, I think... And I wasn't even so stupid. I wasn't even freaking hungry. I'd eaten so much that day. But, like, I was like, oh, I've got to have a feed up after the show. So I went and, like, bought a pizza and 2 McFlurries. And just, like, woofed it down. And then, like... fell asleep on my bed and woke up and had the night sweats, and my bed was just like tan, like it ruined the bed basically. Yeah. So that was sort of some of the stupid shit I used to do. But so I've just got some quick fire questions we're just going to roll through. What would be your last meal on death if you're on death row, and it's a main and a dessert?
Oh, gotta be burgers and fries for the main. Dessert, just ice cream.
Mean. One song to train to for the rest of your life.
Till I collapse.
Nice. Greatest athlete of all time.
Oh.
Across any sport, even if you want to pick bodybuilding, that's all good.
Yeah. Let's go with Chris Bumstead.
Okay, cool. Favorite movie of all time?
Fast and Furious.
Your biggest inspiration?
At the moment, C-Bum.
One piece of advice you would give your 10-year-old self?
Oh, cliche, but never give up.
Nice. Before I wrap up, is there anyone or anything you would like to plug or thank?
Obviously the team at the fitness portal. They're all smashing it down in Wellington at the moment while I'm up here trying to make moves for the Auckland one.
Cool. And for anyone listening, you can follow Tim on Instagram at Tim's_bodybuilding. But bro, thank you so much for jumping on today. I know you've got a lot on your plate, but I'm quite excited to hear you open up a location in Auckland because I live in the Mount. So I'll definitely be up for a train when that opens. But I'm excited to see everything you're doing with the gym and your training, and I'm sure you're going to have a big year.
Yeah, cheers, man. Yeah, it'll be good. We have to come up to the launch party.
Yeah, awesome. Keep in touch. Thanks for watching. If you like this content, please like, subscribe, and share with your friends. And for all things Unbroken Performance and myself, hit the links in the description below.